Good morning and welcome to First St. Paul's Lutheran Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. Isn't it wonderful outside? Waking up to that fresh smell of the rain and the green grass, it's just a wonderful time of year and it's a beautiful day. So thank you for spending it with us this morning. My name's Chad Power. I'm the Children's and Family Ministry Director here. I'm also a seminarian, and so I am actually going to be leading the service for today. So thank you for joining us. As we get started, we've got a couple of announcements. Please turn to them in your bulletin if you'd like to. We do have a couple of things coming up in the next couple of weeks, especially since it's Holy Week. Easter's coming up. There are a couple of these piles of these Easter poster cards that are going out about the services throughout this upcoming Holy Week. There's a stack of them out in the gathering area. We have also mailed them out to people in the community to remind them of the opportunities to worship during Holy Week. If you would like to take a few of these and pass them out to anybody, feel free to grab them from the stacks in the gathering area. And again, it talks about all of the different services from our worship service on Saturday, April 20th, through sunrise services on Sunday, April 21st at 6:30, and then our worship services at breakfast at 7:30, services at 9, 10, and 11. So if you would like to, please feel free to grab some of these and hand them out. With Easter coming up, we have our Easter egg hunt. There's another flyer inside of your bulletin that says April 20th is our Easter egg hunt on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. With an Easter egg hunt, we are in need of Easter egg candy to stuff inside of the Easter egg. So the basket's out in the gathering area. If you would like to donate some candy to the children's Easter egg hunt, we're going to be stuffing those the following week before Saturday the 20th. So please feel free to drop those gifts of candy off in there. You may have noticed a lot of green bags on the table outside there. That's our Easter outreach program. Those are bags that we send out to people that are unable to make it in to services, the shut-ins and people that can't make it. So those bags all have a label on them of who they go to and the address of that person. If you would like to, feel free to grab one or two or three and help distribute those out to those that are unable to make it into the church to worship with us. There's a lot of things dealing with eggs. Oreos, tonight, Oreos is meeting at 6:30 because Pastor Joel is going to start selling some eggs again. This is the actual annual egg sale for the Oreos. They go out and sell eggs to the neighbors around here trying to raise funds for different organizations. And Pastor Joel is in need of three adults to help drive the children. If we have drivers, it allows him to spread out and get into some different neighborhoods instead of just in this area. So if you are willing to drive for Oreos tonight, please talk to Pastor Joel, throughout the morning sometime today. Again, Wednesday night, we have our services at 6 o'clock. We have the opportunity to do the Bible study, the last days of Jesus, right in here in the sanctuary. You can join us to dig in a little bit deeper about those last few days. And 7 o'clock is our Lent service, right in here on 7 o'clock in the evening. Our well is still set up over here, allowing us to drop off Judas purses for the different benefits and the organizations that we are trying to help as they serve the needy. And those can be dropped off in the well. And the last announcement, if you have an eighth grader that is going to be confirmed this year, faith papers are due on April 14th. Those are due to Pastor Andrea, so if they would like to turn those in, those faith papers are due on April 14th. A lot of announcements. We've got a lot of things coming up here in the next few weeks, so please feel free to take a look at those and be sure that you're informed on what's happening around the church. Let us stand. And the peace of Christ be with you always. Let's share that peace with those around us, please. Good morning. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace, Jim. Let us continue our service with a confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us join together in our first opening hymn for Be Thou My Vision, number 793.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God's people on earth. God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God, glory to God, and peace to God's people on earth. Oh, Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Are seated at the right hand of the Father. Seek our prayer. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God, glory to God, and peace to God's people on earth. Abounds in mercy and steadfast love. Be gracious to us. Bring us again with regretful hearts and steadfast faith to hold fast to the unchanging truth of your word. Jesus Christ, your Son, guide us by your Holy Spirit, that through the words of Scripture and sermon, we might be led to Jesus, who alone is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning.
The first reading is taken from Psalm 32, 1 through 8. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Shelah. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Shelah. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you at a time of distress. The rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance. Shelah. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. The second reading is taken from Galatians 3, 23 through 29. Now before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Please stand for the gospel.
Today's gospel comes from the book of Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 19th chapter.
Glory.
He, Jesus that is, entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." The Gospel of the Lord. Please join me in the first three verses of our next hymn, "Take My Life That I May Be," number 685. Please be seated. The last couple of weeks, we've been working through a series of different topics dealing with Walk This Way on the Sunday services. And on Wednesday nights, we've been doing interviews with a few different congregation members about the roadmap and what it means to be on the journey of your faith walk with God. So a couple of weeks ago, Pastor Joel started us off talking a couple of Sundays about the anticipation of going to the Holy Lands and what he was going to experience and hope to experience in walking where Jesus had walked. And in a couple of weeks, we'll hear from Pastor Joel, about his journey through the Holy Lands. And I'll give you a little quick view of one of his photos today during the sermon. So that's why we've got the screen down. And the last couple of weeks, Pastor Andrea has talked about a couple of different stories that have opened the doors to think about some different topics. Judas and the betrayal, the hemorrhaging woman and being unwanted. And last week we talked about the crippled at the side of the pool at Bethsaida and the hopelessness that he had and felt. Today we turn to Zacchaeus, and oh, Zacchaeus was more than just a wee little man. And I'm excited to talk more about that today and hopefully talk about what it's like to be an outsider or lost. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be always acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So in order to understand where we're at with Zacchaeus, you have to understand what's happening in Jesus' life right now. He's on his last and final journey to Jerusalem. He's walking with his disciples to what he knows is going to be the end of his time with us here on this earth, the crucifixion. They're walking into Jericho. And Luke 19 starts out and says, Jesus is on his final journey, but he's walking through Jericho. He's just passing through. That's a key, so think about that. He's just walking through. Real quickly, after he's in Jericho, chapter 19 finishes out by talking about Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which is what we know as Palm Sunday. And then he cleanses the temple from all the money exchangers. So things happen pretty quickly in Luke right after this scene with Zacchaeus in Jericho. Jericho, the city, is a very important city. It's actually identified today as the oldest organized city in the world. Archaeologists have identified that they've had organized living in the Jericho area for over 11,000 years. You do the math, that's 8,000 years before Jesus. So the city has been there for a while. It's an important trade route because it's the only natural opening from the east leading to Jerusalem. So any trade that was going through, Jericho was a place to go. And at this time, when Zacchaeus is looking to see Jesus, the Roman Empire ruled it. And they ruled it with a heavy hand. They had heavy taxes. The Jewish people were being taxed to support the Roman Empire. So that's kind of a picture of what Jericho's like, what Jesus was doing, and he was just planning to pass through. So now our main character, Zacchaeus. Many of us know him as the short, wee little man that had to climb a tree to see Jesus, right? So that story is just the surface. Zacchaeus was Jewish born. He was born into a family of Jews, so he was Jew by birth. But somehow, through the years, when he was trying to establish himself, he worked his way into being the chief tax collector. Now, in the Bible, we only hear chief tax collector once, and it's at this point. So we don't know exactly what that means, but you can kind of assume that he wasn't just a tax collector. He was the boss. He was the leader of the, well, let's call it the taxation department in local Jericho. So he was working with the 12, 15 other tax collectors, making sure the money was coming in, and then he was making sure that the Romans received what they were requiring. So Zacchaeus was a Jew by birth, but he's working for the Roman Empire as a tax collector. And at this time, if you were a Jew by birth and you were working for Rome and you chose to work for Rome, the Jericho people considered you a traitor. They did not like you because you had betrayed them. You were a traitor. So Zacchaeus was an outsider. His own people didn't like him, not only because he was the chief tax collector, but because he was working for the Roman Empire. He chose to work for them. But you know what? Zacchaeus was not just short. Zacchaeus was very rich. Zacchaeus had a lot of money. So he made some choices on the way that he wanted to live. So I'm going to see if my presentation will work here. Pull it up. This is the first public viewing of what I know of as Pastor Joel's pictures from his trip. This is a sycamore tree, and the sun's coming in, so it's a little bit harder to see. The sycamore tree is actually in Jericho. It is the sycamore tree from the story of Zacchaeus. It's 700 years old. Mathematicians, you know, it's not exactly the tree that Zacchaeus was in, but the story that Joel was told in Jericho, when the original tree was dying, they took a sapling off, they planted it, and when that next tree was dying, they took another sapling off and they planted it. So this is an actual sapling of the tree from the story that Zacchaeus climbed in Jericho. But I want to use the other image as we go forward. So the story, we all know it. Zacchaeus was a short guy, wee little man was he, and he couldn't see what was coming. So you've got Zacchaeus, he's a Jew. He's a very rich man, very unpopular with the Jews, an outsider. But he hears of this man passing through Jericho. His name is Jesus. He's curious. He wants to know. There's something about this man that he wants to see. So what does Zacchaeus do? He hurries over to where the crowd is at, and he's trying to get a glimpse. Can you just see him trying to get up on his toes, and he's trying to look over the top, and he's trying to see. But all the Jews that are around Jesus, what are they doing to Zacchaeus? What are you doing, little man? You're the outsider. You're lost. You are not one of us. You've chosen to be with the Rome. We're not going to let you see this Jesus. They kind of barricaded or blocked him so he couldn't see. How do you think Zacchaeus felt? There's this man, Jesus. I don't know much about him, but boy, everybody else does, and he seems to be pretty popular. There's this whole crowd following him through here. So there's something here that I need. There's something that I've got to see about this. I just got to see it. So can you see Zacchaeus? He's kind of in a panic mode. He's like, what can I do? So he sees a tree, and he knows that Jesus and the mob is going to be walking by. When you look at the image, and if you can't see it very well up here, it's on the front of your bulletin, Zacchaeus does something that I consider kind of neat. He's already an outsider. He already knows the Jews don't like him. So he just says, the heck with it. I don't care about my dignity. I want to see who this guy is that's in the middle of this crowd. I'm going to go climb a tree. I don't know how many of you guys grew up on a farm or anywhere out on the outside. And isn't it fun as a child just to climb a tree? You get a whole different perspective on life. And so if you notice in this translation or this interpretation of the story, the artist put some other people in the tree with Zacchaeus. But who are they? They're kids. They're children. Because that's what children like to do. They like to climb trees. They like to see something from a different perspective. So Zacchaeus took himself and said, I don't care about my adult dignity. People don't care about me anyway. I'm already the outsider. I'm going to go climb this tree so I can see Jesus as he walks by. So he throws all his dignity out the door and he climbs the tree in what I consider a childlike action. Ironically, if you think back to the journey that Jesus has taken with his disciples so far, he's talked to them and told them that they need to have a faith like a child. So in this story, Zacchaeus is in a childlike action or a mode. So how do we relate? I've got to relate this back to us today. So we know Zacchaeus, we know what he's doing, what his life is like, what his career is, how he's achieved it, how he's gotten there, and now he's in a tree. But how does that relate to us? Has anybody ever heard the phrase, the American dream? I'm going to read from an excerpt from a book called Radical, written by David Platt. He's a Baptist minister here in the United States. And I'm just going to read this short excerpt, and I'm going to come back to another one later on. So try and carry some of this through as I pull things together here for you. David Platt writes, "As the American dream goes, we can do anything we set our minds to accomplish. There is no limit to what we can accomplish when we combine our ingenuity, our imagination, and our innovation with skill and hard work. We can earn any degree, start any business, climb any ladder, attain any prize, and achieve any goal." James Truslow Adams, who is credited with coining the phrase American Dream in the year 1931, spoke of it as a dream in which each man and each woman shall be able to attain to the fullest stature of which they are innately capable and be recognized by others for what they are. So we all know the American dream. Home, family, cars, good retirement account, work hard, I can do this, you've got to have an education. Those of you that are teenagers thinking about college, you've got to have that right education so that you can get that good job that's really well paying, and you've got to work your tail off in your academics to get there. But Zacchaeus, had he achieved his American dream? He worked his tail off. He achieved the chief tax collector position, the top tax collector position for the Roman Empire in Jericho. He had money. He had authority, success. He was in charge of people. But still, there was something missing. And in his panic to see Jesus, that unknown of what he is listening, he felt lost. The outsider position, being pushed outside. In the middle of the story, Jesus is still walking down the street in the crowd, and he comes to the tree. And in verse 9, in Luke 19, it says, "When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, 'Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today.'" So I got to dissect that a little bit. First of all, the very beginning, a few verses earlier, it says Jesus was just passing through Jericho. But now, in verse 5, it says, "Zacchaeus, I must stay at your house today." So what has made Jesus change his plan? The other thing is, how did Jesus know who this man was up in the tree? He's passing through Jericho and this mob comes around him. Think about all the faces and all the people that are around him as he's walking through. And yet, he comes to a place, he looks up, and he sees this man. What did Jesus do? Jesus knows at this time he's walking through Jericho because he's on the way to Jerusalem to be crucified. Jesus knew that he was trying to, in these last few days, help his disciples see what their purpose and what their meaning is going to be for their lives and for others after he's gone. But as he's walking through Jericho, he sees this man, possibly with children, in a tree, trying to get a glimpse of him. And Jesus doesn't just see a man and a little man. He looks not on the exterior, but the interior. And he sees Zacchaeus' heart. And he says, "Zacchaeus, come down. I need to stay with you today." Jesus saw that Zacchaeus needed something. Zacchaeus needed to be redirected in his life. And so he invited him down. When Jesus walked away with Zacchaeus to his house, what did the rest of the Jews say that were mobbed around Jesus? They said, he is going to the house of that man, that sinner. He's the tax collector. How could Jesus go with him? But Jesus didn't care. Zacchaeus didn't care. Zacchaeus, and we don't know, it doesn't go into any more depth. There's no other story in the book of the Bible that talks about the story of Zacchaeus. So we don't know what happened between the time of the tree and Zacchaeus repenting. But something happened, and Zacchaeus' heart had changed. His whole outlook on life changed. He repented. He stood up. It says he stood up and he said, Lord, I have done wrong. Lord, I'm going to repay everything that I've done to those, and those that I have wronged, I'm going to pay back four times the amount. You see, Jesus sought Zacchaeus out that day. A man who was certainly among the lost, he couldn't figure out what he needed, but Jesus didn't leave him there. He stopped, and he gave him the opportunity to be saved. Back to David Platt and the American dream. David Platt states, the dangerous assumption we unknowingly accept in the American dream is that our greatest asset is our own ability. The American dream prizes what people can accomplish when they believe in themselves and trust in themselves, and we are drawn toward such thinking. But the gospel has different priorities. The gospel beckons us to die to ourselves and to believe in God and to trust in his power. In the gospel, God comforts us with our utter inability to accomplish anything of value apart from him. So Zacchaeus had the career, he had the money, he was an outcast, but he didn't matter. He was happy with the life that he chose. Jesus saw different. And in verse 10, comes back and states, for the Son of Man came to seek out, and to save the lost. So just for the record, this story of Zacchaeus was not intentionally put 10 days before tax day. Taxes are due in about a week now. So this story of the tax collector was not intentionally placed here because of the tax day. But we're all going through that process, aren't we? Of evaluating 2018's taxes, where our finances are, planning for 2019, trying to see how we're going to be set up for our taxes for next year. As you go through that, I challenge you to stop and think about how we live our lives and how you are living your lives. Think about, are we achieving these things by our own power? Or is it through God and the faith that we have in God? Because just like Zacchaeus, if we're lost, Jesus is here to open the door for us. He's here to bring us back into the fold. Jesus just wants you and I on the correct path to God's American dream for us. Amen. Please join me in our hymn number 685, Take My Life That I May Be, verses 4 through 6.
At this time, let's have the prayers of the day. I will end each petition with, "Hear us, O God. Please respond. Your mercy is great." Seeking the grace, mercy, and love of an almighty God, we offer our prayers for the church and the people in need and for all creation. God of resurrection and a new life, inspire your church to reconsider what it takes to make us holy. When we face and focus on our even piety in others, show us Christ's faithfulness. Hear us, O God. Whenever destruction by flood, famine, or fire has devastated land and lives, cause green shoots to spring up, giving hope and vision for your promised future. Hear us, O God. Where nations are embroiled in chaos and unrest, cut a clear path for your people to follow. Lead us in ways of reconciliation and foretell the new things that you prepare us. Hear us, O God. Wipe away the tears of those who weep under the burdens of hard labor and despair. And this morning we think especially of Hazel Husky, Sharon Peters, Shirley Gronewald, Pat Olson, Delma Bartling, Alice Kruger, Sherry Corgan. Restore them and bring them into the joy of your presence. Hear us, O God. And so in thanksgiving for those who have died in the faith, this morning we think especially of Barb Gardner, Mary Elizabeth Anderson, Ken Bolin, that the grace of Christ in their life guide us in our vocation as Christians throughout the world. Let us pray and have mercy, O God. Permeate this world with the sweet perfume of Christ's meaning. Fill your people with such gratitude that it spills over into service of those who are poor or in any need. Hear us, O God. And accompany those for whom death draws near. Bring us with all your saints and receive the abundance of your heavenly glory through the covenant that Christ sealed in the death and resurrection. Hear us, O God. Reveal your will as you receive our prayers and confirm our ways to your ways through the saving work of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's reverse course and can join me together with the Nicene Creed found at the bottom of page 4. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, we will receive our gifts and offerings. Please be seated.
Let us pray. Generous God, you feed us with the harvest of the land, and you provide for our every need. Receive our gifts of money, imagination, and labor, and transform them into a feast that welcomes all. In Jesus Christ, our host and our guest. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for this feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending ending him.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the
And at this time, we remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, giving it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Every time you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." And let us pray as our Father has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, I have good news for you today. Christ has died and Christ has risen and Christ will come again. If you believe in the promises of Jesus, then you are welcome to the communion table. At this time, I invite forward those that will be assisting with communion. The congregation may be seated. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
All right. Yeah, no, you'll do.
For the blessing. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful God, at your feast you fed us who brought nothing. You turned our emptiness into joy. You filled us with your abundant grace. Now send us to be ministers into the world, mending broken hearts, working for justice, seeking the lost, and striving for peace among all people. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Our closing hymn today is number 776, What God Ordains is Good Indeed.
Thank you.
in peace and serve our Lord.